Welcome, everyone. Welcome to Korea Society. It is my great pleasure to welcome you to today's Young Professionals Luncheon with Dr. Kyung-wha Kang in conversation with Vivian Lee. Before introducing our speakers, I would like to thank the two organizations which collaborated with us on this program, Young Professionals in Foreign Policy and Gori Social Club. The aim of this Young Professional series is to introduce amazing people from various fields to inspire us and to learn from. So I am so pleased to introduce Kyung-wha Kang. This is the season of giving, but Ms. Kang, as a UN Assistant Secretary General for Humanitarian Affairs, works to help people every day. Before assuming this position in March, she was in Geneva for 6 years as the Deputy High Commissioner for Human Rights. Sorry, there's a little more. Before joining the UN, Ms. Kang worked at Korea's Ministry for Foreign Affairs and Trade and served as minister in her country's permanent mission to the UN from 2001 to 2005, during which period she chaired the Commission on the Status of Women. Ms. Kang graduated from Yonsei University with a BA in Political Science and Diplomacy. She also has a Master's in Mass Communications and a PhD in Intercultural Communications from the University of Massachusetts Amherst. And on top of that, she's a proud mother of three. Joining her today is Vivian Lee, who you all probably recognize from New York One's news team. Ms. Lee joined New York One in 2008 as an anchor and reporter, just as Wall Street market meltdown unfolded. Since then, she has anchored and reported from the field on breaking stories of local and national interest. She was live on New York One's air in March from St. Peter's Square when the new Pope was elected. And several months before that, she reported on Hurricane Sandy from Lower Manhattan. And last summer, she broke the story of fake gold bars being sold in Manhattan's Diamond District, triggering a federal investigation. Vivian was also a reporter for WNBC for 6 years and before that in Canada. Vivian graduated from Carleton University's journalism program in Ottawa, and as a true Canadian, lists fly fishing as one of her hobbies. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Claudia, and welcome, everybody. Welcome, Dr. Kyung-wha Kang.
Thank you very much.
I'm going to go right into the questions so that we don't waste any more time. I've got a list of about a dozen. And you can take however long as you want. This is a very friendly interview for the sake of our guests this afternoon so that they can understand what motivated you throughout your entire life. We're hoping that in the next 45 minutes you can encapsulate in a nutshell what it is that drives you in your work, as well as the balance that's required to make that work meaningful for you, as well as being a wife and mother. So we're going to start off with the first couple of questions on your career path. If you can describe the career path that Claudia just went through briefly, and maybe describe how each position that you took was a manifestation of the interests that you had in humanitarian aid and affairs, human rights, and perhaps you can start off with what sparked that interest in the first place.
Well, thank you very much, Vivian, and greatly honored and happy to be here with you, Vivian, first of all, and thanks to Korea Society for giving me this opportunity to meet with young professionals. I hope this talk is worth your time. You've waited quite a bit. But I would say, first of all, I'm not an ambitious person, but I'm a very curious person, interested in all matters of things on earth. It's always been somewhat, you know, my belief from the very beginning that I would be working outside the country. Somehow the world would be my stage and that I would seek work beyond the borders of my own country. And I had parents who were very supportive in that regard. I don't recall any time my father and mother said no. So they were very supportive and very open-minded about the options that I wanted to explore. So, you know, I really went for opportunities that came my way rather than going after opportunities. But, I think the one opportunity that I really tried hard and in the end got was the entry into the foreign ministry. As we all know, foreign ministries tend to be very exclusive and they don't take people mid-career that often. So that took quite a while, many years of trying, but I got in. But other than that, you know, this opportunity with the UN Human Rights Office and this opportunity also, I'm greatly enjoying this job, but I think the point is you have to be prepared when the opportunity comes your way. You have to have the qualification and you have to present yourself in a way that meets the expectations of those who hire you. I think human rights and humanitarian affairs are intrinsically the interest of everybody. I think we're all interested in human rights. We're all interested in the dignity and freedom of people. And we all, you know, have hearts that bleed when we hear about human suffering. So the humanitarian inclination is compassion towards human suffering. The human rights impulse is anger when injustices are being happening and fellow human beings are treated with less than the dignity that they deserve and they are born with. So I really believe that human rights and humanitarian affairs are everybody's business. Now, there are some people who make a profession out of that, such as, those of us working in the UN, whether it's humanitarian work or human rights work. But then once you get into that professional community, there's a certain modality of working within that community, and you have to get used to it. The human rights work has been, the mainstay, one of the mainstay of the United Nations work since the very birth of the organization in 1945. And the whole human rights architecture of the United Nations is built upon that foundation document, the UN Charter and the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. Now, that declaration is the most frequently translated document in the whole world. There are like over 400 versions of the Universal Declaration, far more than any religious text. So I think that's an indication of how much it has the ideals and the spirit and the words of the declaration have penetrated all over the world into the smallest of communities. So the rights consciousness is really, something that the world, the whole human community shares. And if that's the rights consciousness is on the part of every human being around the world, and that's one of the things that I really, am impressed whenever I go into the deep field, whether it's carrying my human rights hat or my humanitarian hat, the victims themselves are just so conscious about their rights. They know what their rights are. They know that they're being violated, and they demand that they be respected, that the violations stop, and the crimes brought to justice. So that's the demand out there. So how can we not do that work? And the UN's work in human rights and humanitarian tries to meet that demand coming from the ground. My current work is humanitarian. The current crisis in the Philippines, which is a natural disaster crisis, the ongoing protracted crisis in Syria, which is the fallout basically of civil war that the big political players failed to stop and continue to fail to stop the ongoing violence. So in the end, sometimes as humanitarians, we're there to pick up the pieces and do damage control where politicians and the political leaders are unable to deliver their side of their responsibilities. I'm getting off on a little bit of a tangent here, but I think the UN's value in all of this is that UN is the most universal organization. Almost all countries of the world except one or two are members of the United Nations. So it gives that universality, and with that universality comes with great moral weight. So whatever you do wearing that UN hat, you have that authority that you are speaking with universality.
What would you say was the seminal job or position, perhaps back in Korea, that prepared you to eventually join the UN?
Well, it wasn't more of a job. It was a time-bound task. When we were preparing for the Beijing Fourth World Conference on Women organized by the United Nations, At that point, I was teaching at a university, and I was involved with women's organizations. And as women's organizations, not government delegations, but NGOs, we were preparing to go to Beijing, we decided it would be so much more effective to go with one voice rather than individuals going by themselves. So we organized what was called the Korea Women's NGO Committee. I think it was some 96, 98 organizations together under that umbrella. And, you know, it was a great experience because it just, you know, women's organizations with different views, different ideologies coming together, going with one voice, and me as the spokesperson for that committee. And we were in Huairu, which was where the NGO forum was taking place. So every day, you know, leading this group of very active, very committed women organization and their leaders, and to distill that voice into a public communication material on a daily basis was a great experience. And I think we really made it a splash on the comfort women issue at the NGO forum. And for me personally, it was a realization of how, you know, my God, I thought, you know, this discrimination and this was just my issue, you know, and the difficulty of balancing work and job, I thought that was just my issue, and maybe to share with just a few other women in these organizations in Korea. But I realized it was a global issue. The United Nations was dealing with this issue, and they had thrown this big bash of a conversation as the World Women's Conference to have a discussion. And that was such a revelation for me. You know, when growing up, Korea is a country that was very much reliant on the international community for its peace, for its stability, for its development. And the United Nations was a big part of it. So we grow up being very grateful to the UN. We grow up with that affection and sympathy, but we don't know exactly what the UN does on a daily basis. So in Beijing, that was just so clear. So ever since that point, I think that the idea that UN is so immediate to me and the issues that I deal with on a daily basis, then I think that led to a desire to, you know, whenever there was an opportunity, I would want to work in the United Nations. And so when the opportunity came, you know, in the foreign ministry, I chose a career path that worked on UN issues. And then when this opportunity with the High Commission for Human Rights came up, I, at the encouragement of many friends, I wasn't so sure that I would get it, but many friends encouraged. So I applied and got it.
How would you advise any of us here who might be interested in a career working with the UN or within the UN? Mm. How would you advise that person to start?
No, I think you have to be prepared. The UN's recruitment system is a very cumbersome one, all for this idea of transparency, so that every job, as a matter of principle, is open search. Every job is advertised online. If you, with a few clicks, you can find out which vacancies and which departments where. So once the jobs are open, there's thousands and, you know, sometimes hundred, you know, over 1,000 applications that come in for every vacancy. So if you want to get noticed and not be screened out at the first round, you really need to have the minimum qualifications. And those are very clearly spelled out in the job description. I would advise, instead of saying, I want to work for the UN, you have to decide what cause you want to dedicate your life to. Is it the environment? Is it, you know, climate change? Is it human rights? Is it humanitarian assistance? Within humanitarian assistance, is it medical assistance? Is it shelter? So you really, you know, think through the cause. And if you know, you know, if you've said, this is really what I want to dedicate my life to, then you need to build a track record of experience in that field, whether it's within a national setting or an international setting, any public entity or an NGO, and to have those years of minimum qualifications. So, for example, if you're applying to a P2, I think you need 3 years minimum. P3, it's 5 years. And that is a really important point. I don't think applicants fully appreciate the importance of that qualification. To have that, to spell out your experience that fully justifies you being able to say, I have this many years of experience to meet this qualification in this field.
And what is P2, P3, et cetera?
P2 is the entry level, professional level 2. P3 is the next, P4, P5. P5 would be where, in the Korean setting, we would call 과장, you know, manager of your department. So from the P5, you get into management positions. And then there's above that, there are director position, the D1 and the D2. And my level, the assistant secretary general level, would be the political level. So assistant secretary general, under secretary general, then we have one deputy secretary general, Mr. Jan Eliasson, and then we have the secretary general.
Okay, so now you know what to reach for. Moving on to maybe some more details on exactly what you do. I had the privilege of meeting with Dr. Kang earlier before we sat down up here. And there was one thing in particular that I was curious about. As a reporter, I'm very used to covering the details behind the headlines. But what's never fully explained to me mm-hmm. is the conflict that can often arise, which I kind of feel is patently there. Mm-hmm. The conflict that exists between working on human rights issues and answering the need, the call for humanitarian aid requirements. Mm-hmm. Sometimes you'll have a situation such as in the South Sudan, mm-hmm. where you have a man-made conflict mm-hmm. that sparks, it espouses human rights violations, while at the same time creating a huge burst of need in humanitarian aid mm-hmm. and emergency relief work. Mm-hmm. When you are asked to handle a project, mm. so here is a province where you have thousands of people mm. dying and millions displaced, how do you prioritize what to handle first? Mm-hmm. Because they often go hand in hand, the mm-hmm. human rights violation as well as the humanitarian mm-hmm. aid work.
Well, I think there are two different communities. I say always that the human rights and humanitarians are siblings. We're born of the same mother, but we've developed different modalities of working. Human rights work, based upon all the human rights norms that have been developed, based on the Universal Declaration, the basic modality is to go to duty bearers, the governments, or non-state armed groups who have control over population, and to tell them about their behavior, good behavior, bad behavior. Because in the end, human rights is about how governments, those in power, treat their own people. So the human rights work is to point out what is wrong with that and what is, you know, they're doing well. So basically to tell the bad guys, you're bad, you know, to put it very simply. Humanitarian work is to talk to the same authorities who have control over populations to say, we want to help the people who are suffering. Let us help your people. Give us the access to help them, right? And sometimes that dialogue is easy when governments know that they need help and they welcome humanitarians to go and help their people. Sometimes that dialogue is very difficult, so it comes like, please, please let us help your people. When, in fact, they have the primary responsibility to care for and take care of their people. So that's a very difficult dialogue that humanitarians have to have, the whole issue of access. And without that access, if you're not given the visas, you can't go into the country, right? If you're not given the permission or the consent, and we argue that that consent can never be held back arbitrarily, but there's a whole discussion as what counts as arbitrary. We push for consent and access that is unfettered. But that is a very, very difficult discussion, depending upon certain governments. So it's a different nature of work that human rights and humanitarians do, but they are absolutely complementarity if you look at it from the view of the victims. Yeah? They want the rights protected, violations revealed, and also the assistance coming in.
But then how do you convince, say, a government that doesn't want to help the injured among the rebel factions? Mm-hmm. How do you convince that government that that is part of their duty to do, mm-hmm. or at least to give you the access to do the work for them?
The fundamental principle of humanitarian work is that it is based on needs and needs only, regardless of the ethnicity, the nationality, the political affiliation of those with the needs. And to be able to do that, you have to be able to reach them. And they come under sometimes rebel groups, non-state armed groups, even terrorist groups, groups that are labeled as terrorist, as well as people under government control. And it is accepted that humanitarians need to be able to talk not only to governments, but also to these non-state armed groups. And we do that all the time. We do that in Syria, we do that in South Sudan, wherever there is war going on and there you have warring parties that have control over populations.
You recently held a news conference for journalists at the UN mm-hmm. after coming back from South Sudan. Mm-hmm. One of the things that jumped out at me when I reviewed that news conference, because you can go online and see it, mm-hmm. Was a question that came out about the child soldier situation mm-hmm. in South Sudan, mm-hmm. whether you were able to address it at all. Mm-hmm. Could you perhaps tell our audience today mm-hmm. what your conclusions were after coming back from that trip?
Uh-huh. I think if I could just roll back to your point about the tension, I wouldn't necessarily call it a conflict or a contradiction, but tension between human rights work and humanitarian work. It is also a huge lessons learned from the whole UN system that human rights violations are the earliest signs of crisis coming on. You have systematic human rights violations and violence taking place. And that is the clearest sign of something terrible about to happen. And this we saw in the CAR. This we saw in Syria. And so it's, you know, the human rights violations becoming systematized, becoming more violent, more brutal. And then bang, you have, you know, the outbreak of violence and conflict. Then that leads to humanitarian crisis, lives lost, injured, displaced, and so on and so forth. So that's a lesson that the UN system under the Secretary General is learning in a very hard kind of a way from our experience in Sri Lanka. We all know that we failed in Sri Lanka during the final days of the war by you know, too much concentrating on the day-to-day operations and being a bit oblivious to the human rights violations that have been going on for many, many years and becoming more and more systematized and brutal. And of course, the human rights office at that time wanted to speak out and we spoke up, but the system as a whole was sort of in denial, didn't want to deal with that because there were daily operations to be undertaken, daily humanitarian projects to be undertaken and so on and so forth. But it's so clear and I think well understood and appreciated and bought into that we have to take these human rights violations as the early signs of something terrible about to happen. And therefore, these violations have to be dealt with, stopped, prevented, and the perpetrators brought to justice so as to prevent the situation from getting out of hand. In South Sudan, what I saw was not so much an issue of child soldiers, but the legacies of the war that has resulted in just, you know, scores of young children in a country that is just 2 years old with very little capacity, very little infrastructure to take care of their own people. So little children, I mean, just breaks my heart every time I look at little kids out of school and just, you know, wasting their very precious time on the streets. And I saw so many of them on the streets of South Sudan. Once we got out of Juba and went into Bor. So it's not so much a child soldier situation, and I don't think that's the key issue in terms of child protection at this point. But it's really what to do about these these orphans, street children. There are some NGOs, who have taken them in, and in fact, a Korean NGO has set up an orphanage in Bortown to take care of them, but just not enough. And the idea of a fully fledged educational system for this young country is a very ambitious aspiration, but. Given my experience coming from Korea, a country with really nothing, but the aspiration of the people for education, this is something that I emphasize, whether wearing my human rights hat or humanitarian hat, that if you had a pot of money to spend, spend it on education, especially girls' education.
Why do you say especially girls' education?
Because girls don't get equal treatment. When crises happen, crises tend to amplify existing social order, social structure. So if it's a society where there's gender discrimination, crises tend to reinforce that. Crises also gives us an opportunity to start from scratch. But if you don't make an extra effort, you see girls being pulled out of school in the first instance when the family has dwindling financial resources. So it's not even, big crisis, let's say financial difficulties. In these developing countries with very little family income, it's often the girls who will be pulled out of school because the family can't afford all the kids anymore. And then instead of going to school, the girl will be put to errands or even, generate income for the family. And we see this in countries with financial crisis. We see this in humanitarian crisis situations. Even humanitarians are frequently blind to these gendered dimension of community response. Even humanitarians reinforce that existing discriminatory structures.
So, is that because of a lack of women among humanitarian aid groups in decision-making positions?
I think that is in some cases. I don't think it's in OCHA. In OCHA, the top two are women. In some organizations, I think that is the case. And when you go to the field, it is still very much male. So we really have to go the extra mile, and to really reach out to the communities to, look beyond the surface level observations. I think many aid agencies now come to realize that you need to give the resources to the women and not the men. Because if you give the resources to the women, she will use it for the family. If you give the resources to the man, head of the house, he will most likely spend it on what he sees as the priorities, which isn't necessarily the family priorities. So aid agencies where they're distributing food items or non-food items really make a point of getting women heads, getting women leaders of communities to be on the receiving end. So that that I could see in the DRC, that I could see in the South Sudan. But even beyond that, you need to really search, where are the young girls? What are they doing in this crisis?
Well, that dovetails, I think, with a few years ago, the UN had clearly stated how the health of almost any community you measure around the world mm-hmm. comes down to the state of health, both mental and physical, of the women
yes.
in households, like yeah. at that very basic
yes.
unit yeah. level.
Mm-hmm. And I think that's another attempt to say, unless it really takes an extra effort to get at to the root of the discrimination, and that which manifests itself in not just in terms of education, in terms of how the whole health system is established, and how families use their resources on caring for the health of their family members. And I remember growing up, my mother would, her own health would be the last thing on her mind. Even though I think, I want my mother to be healthy. I think it really need, mothers and young mothers in particular to be healthy, to be able to provide and care for the children.
On that note, I'm going to segue into another humanitarian aid arena, which is the Philippines, has been on a lot of people's minds, especially in the recent past. Could you please describe what the situation is there now, now that the initial response time has passed? I think there is a sense that there's another wave of perhaps not crisis, but emergency now upon us because the removal of the dead, getting certain infrastructural needs met is probably underway. But now what is the concern in terms of getting the population back to a stable status again?
It's been exactly a month since the Haiyan stroke. The current figures are 14 million people affected and 4 million displaced. Yesterday, we just launched the appeal for next year to the tune of something like $792 million for humanitarians as a whole to do our work in support of the government and in support of the people. We very much emphasize the point that this is in support of the government's endeavors. The Philippines was one of those countries that we always touted as a model of being disaster prepared because it's so used to these disasters, earthquakes, floods, and typhoons. But this one was just, the scale of it and intensity of it was just overwhelming. So the international community went in very quickly. I think certainly not enough. Still a lot to be done, but the relief effort have greatly scaled up. 4 million people now assisted with food and shelter continuing to be built. I understand there are still some pockets of very remote area that have yet to be reached, and I think we're trying really hard to do that. The difficulty initially was, of course, that the roads were just all clogged up with debris. So initially it was a lot of airlift going in and dropping things into communities. The foreign military assets were vital. The massive military logistics and personnel support coming in was very much crucial and very much needed. Now they're mostly leaving, so that's a huge challenge. How do you take care of the logistics needs when these military assets withdraw? The Philippine government is quick to move from this emergency phase and tie that into the recovery phase. So just as we have announced the humanitarian appeal for next year yesterday, the government itself will make a recovery appeal in the days to come so that the humanitarian assistance is to tie it into early recovery efforts. One vital element these days is the upcoming farming season. The harvest has completely been lost, and it really need to make an extra pitch to help the farming communities start the farming season with the seedlings and so on and so forth. So there are pockets of focused activity that needs to be done under in terms of early recovery and livelihood. And I think that's the focus of attention these days. I'm very much hoping to be able to go and see for myself.
What about medical supplies? People often want to physically buy the supplies that they think are needed and have it shipped over. But our experiences with Haiti, for example, showed us, no, the best thing to do is to donate money to a reputable charitable source and allow them to coordinate with other authorities get those supplies themselves. But what do you know for yourself firsthand is definitely needed over there?
In fact, we've had communication from some communities saying, oh, I've heard from my friend there that they don't have enough medicine, they don't have enough equipment for a surgery. And so every time we do that, we quickly check back. But in all the cases that we have checked, there are health professionals led by the authorities themselves with the support of the international community doing and, providing the medical care. Now, that doesn't mean that all communities are taken care of or covered. There could still be. But I think the concern isn't, there's huge pockets that are being left out in this. But in terms of the assistance material coming in, you're absolutely right. The you know, there's lots that are turned back at the airport. Because, yes, despite all the goodwill, what is needed on the ground is not what, you know, comes from foreign countries. So we really make the appeal for, please give us the funds with which we can secure the needed material, whether it's medicine or shelter or food. So there's a whole logistics that goes on just at the airport to sort through what is needed, what should be kept, and what should be set aside and returned. And that's a big part of the humanitarian operation as well.
What's the item that's returned the most?
I don't know in the Philippine situation, but there were food cases where blankets, for example.
Interesting.
But, you know, for blankets, Syria is winterization needs of Syria is enormous. And I think so if those blankets could be shifted to the Syria response, that would be good. Now, I don't know if this is the case in the Philippines, but I think these things happen.
Okay. Turning now to the more personal side of this talk, we've heard a lot about leaning in lately, and especially what that means for women. The challenges of juggling your personal or your family life, along with developing a meaningful role for yourself in whatever career you have chosen. Mm-hmm. You have three grown children. You mentioned to me earlier, one son is studying still in Boston. You have two daughters also studying art in Geneva. Mm-hmm. And your husband remains in Korea while you are here. So I can't think of anyone better to ask for your particular definition and method of leaning in and making all of that work.
Mm-hmm. I don't think I'm a particularly leaning in kind of a person. And I think I still have that old inclination that sort of tends to lean out, you know. I don't get into things unless I'm absolutely sure that I'm qualified and I know that I can do the job. I tend to say, you know, look at it very carefully and say, no, I don't have that qualification, and so I won't do it. But I know lots of people who do it. So, but I think one of the things that was clear for me, you know, with my husband was that, you know, we knew from the very beginning that I would have a career. I would want a career and that he would be supportive. So, and he's been very good keeping his end of the bargain on that. So you have to be clear what you want in life. And I don't, you know, I think some women who are, would say, you know, nothing in life would make them more happier than just, you know, creating a happy home for the husband and kids. That's fine too. But I think I was very clear that was not, you know, that's not me. I would want another aspect to it. And he was very supportive, and he's been so far very much kept to that pledge. I think if you judge me as a wife and a mother, I'm probably not that an ideal, you know, because, I mean, how many hours do you have in a day? You can't be the perfect mother and the perfect wife. I always say, you know, do the best you can and don't care too much about the grade you get. But I also didn't push my, you know, husband or kids to say, you know, this is what I do. You know, this is my work. You have to understand it. You have to appreciate it. And you have to fully support me. You know, you do your work. I do my work. My kids also, I didn't, you know, there are two are artists and one is an engineer. And I made an extra effort to let them sort of blossom in a way that finds their own inclination without me driving the message that public service is the way you need to spend your life. So they first of all, they love me, they respect my work, and they're happy that I'm in a place where I am happy to be. But they're not saying, oh, my mother is this, you know, this great leader in the UN system, you know, doing all these wonderful things. That's not them.
And you like it that way.
I like it that way.
Do you mind my asking what your husband does?
My husband is a professor of computer science in Korea. Yes. And we've been in this situation for now going seventh year. But I go back to Korea often. And so I'm able to keep that tie, and not just with my husband, but I have, you know, by the way, my parents-in-law have also been very supportive, and certainly my mother also.
Okay. I personally am interested in hearing any anecdotes, stories that you may have, or lessons that you learned or perhaps were able to teach others on the value of being a woman in the workplace. Mm. This extends from my curiosity about your experiences with sexism in the workplace, and whether it was when you were first starting out in your working life or now, if you have any insight as to the state of sexual stereotyping and prejudices that exist not only in Korean culture, because there are still many tales of how it does exist, as well as in American culture, as well as in the various intercultural spheres that you work with at the UN.
Mm. I think it's a very different situation, generally speaking, you know, comparing now and when I was just starting out my career. After my degree, I went back to Korea thinking, you know, I would be welcomed and to become a faculty member at any of these universities. Boy, was I wrong, you know. And they were so blatant about the discrimination. You know, I would go put my application and the admin officer was, oh, we would never expect a woman to apply for this. And these are just university teaching positions, right? So for about 3-4 years, I was what we called 보따리 장사, you know, lecturer, getting very minimum pay. I think it was sheer exploitation of my women. So, you know, but I was, you know, the point about me not being that ambitious, I thought, you know, I wasn't, you know, wanting to grab something. I thought, eventually I'll get into a university, I'll teach, I'll research, I'll do, you know, I'll go to international conferences, blah, blah, blah. But then, bang, this opportunity at the National Assembly came up. So I went in, and that was the start of my public service career.
And which position was that exactly?
I was one of the advisors to the Speaker of the National Assembly. Hmm. And the Speaker of the National Assembly in Korea is protocol-wise, the number two. So, you know, after the president is the Speaker, and then I think after that is the Prime Minister. Yeah. So protocol-wise, very important. But in terms of the political decision making, it could be rather ceremonial. I think these days it's much more, you know, it's more proactive. It's the speaker's voice and how he or she weighs in. Well, we didn't have a she yet. It's still a he. is very vital to the way parliament is run. But in those times, it was largely ceremonial. But there was a lot of interesting work in terms of inter-parliamentary diplomacy. Mm-hmm. The speaker would travel and I would travel with him. But then I thought, you know, if we're doing international relations and cooperation, why not join the mainstream? So then I decided I would go and ask to enter the foreign ministry. So then I was in the foreign ministry. I think there is, of course, much less blatant sexual discrimination here in the States, Korea, and the United Nations. I think the United Nations at this point is leaning the other way under the leadership of the Secretary General. He's really making a push to give women places of prominence. You know, he will not take any recommendation for any senior position that doesn't include a woman candidate. And if you do, he will most likely go for the women. So managers really try hard to go after qualified women candidates. And I don't have the exact numbers, but he's really, you know, changed the looks of this top leadership of the UN. Yesterday, we were having a discussion on, what was it, Afghanistan, and the DSG was chairing, and there was about 15 people around the table, more women than men. Mm-hmm. But, you know, often across the table when we're talking to counterparts outside the system. For example, when the Secretary General is meeting ministers from other countries, and so it's them and us, sometimes they're all just men. And so it's good, it's, I mean, the SG likes to send that signal that I am doing this, you should also. But I think there is a lingering of, you know, which is very difficult for me to, you know, to do. And I think it's probably the same with you, Vivian. There's a little bit of, you know, in the back of my mind, there's this constant questioning of, am I being treated this way because I'm a woman? Plus, am I being treated this because I'm a Korean and an Asian? When you're dealing with, you know, when the going is good and everything's working out, great collaboration, none of that. But when the going gets tough, you don't get what you want. There are conflicts and disagreements, and you're being let down. You have a question: is this because I'm a woman and I'm a Korean? And I really have to try hard to, you know, not to read meaning where there is no meaning, basically. You know, when the other side has said something, to take that at face value, and not to be suspicious, not to second guess what he or she is saying. I think that's a very unhealthy way to, you know, work on a daily basis. But it's so easy to get into that, and I've seen so many colleagues get into that mind trap. And you become psychotic in the end, you know? Especially when you're in a leadership position and when you have to deal with staff from so many different cultures, and you have to really approach the situation just with basic trust. You're going to just take things at face value, give people the benefit of the doubt until and unless you are given, you know, compelling evidence that this is not happening and there's really something, going on that was, you know, totally behind your back or something. I really, really tried, you know, push my confidence in people.
Finally, I think my last question to you will be this one, because I want to give people, are we okay for time? I think I want to give the floor and our guests a chance to ask you their questions. Can you list a highlight and a low light from your career?
I'm in a way, I always say, you know, I'm just so grateful for every day and every job that I've been able to undertake and enjoy. I've learned so much from these experiences. So there are so many highlights in that regard, but I think highlight, because of the difficulty and because of the you know, because it was such a juxtaposition of the evil and the goodness of human beings. You know, 3 years ago, I think, wearing my previous hat, there were such terrible things happening in the Democratic Republic of the Congo in the Eastern Province, where, you know, armed conflicts still continue because of, you know, just the countless numbers of armed groups fighting government forces. And in the midst of it, sexual violence against women has become a tool of war. Not just random, spontaneous rapes, but intentional, systematic rape as a tool of submission, you know, to make the point that, you know, we are on top of you, you are our the best thing to destroy a community is to destroy their women. And this was what was happening in the DRC. And so we just said, clear my agenda. I want to go and talk to these women themselves. What is happening to them? And how are they being, what is their life after these terrible experiences? So we went to that area. We traveled to the very remote corners and talked to these women, just to get, you know, just to understand that terrible experience and to see if there was enough support coming their way and how what would it take to reclaim their dignity and their lives? That was a hugely, hugely touching, inspiring, because every one of these women were not defeated. Were not defeated. They wanted their lives back. They wanted to take their kids. You ask them, what do you want? And the first thing they would ask is, once their bodies and their minds have somewhat recovered, when some of them are just completely destroyed, but once they're somewhat back in terms of health and mental stability, the next thing they ask is for, I need to send my kids to school. How do I send my kids to school? So it was terrible. I mean, it's the level of brutality was unimaginable. But in the midst of this, you had these victims. And then you had these, you know, angels, you know, doctors, NGOs, you know, at the risk of their own lives, were there to support these women, to take them in, to take care of them, to support them. So you see the best and the worst of humanity in these situations. So that was a very revealing experience for me. But, you know, you see this on the ground to varying degrees. But that, I think, because just the length of it and because of the intensity of the conversation I had with the victims, that was probably one of the most memorable experience for me. The lowest... Let me think about that a little more. Maybe I'll think of something, but maybe I can come back to that afterwards.
Okay. Well, thank you, Dr. Kang, for your candor and your openness in describing your experiences, both personal and professional. I'm sure everybody really enjoyed it. And I'm sure there may be some questions out there, too, for anyone.
We invite anyone who has a question to step up to the mic, if that's okay.
And if you could identify yourself and then pose your question, that would be appreciated.
First of all, thank you very much. That was very enlightening. My name is Andy Nahas. I run an investment firm here in town. I have a question about the way we look at human rights. I think a lot of us think of human rights as focused on how a government treats its own people. And I wonder if you feel that definition is sometimes flawed and that maybe it should be expanded to include how governments treat foreigners as well, you know, outside their borders. And you know, if we look at China versus the U.S., for example, in the U.S., we tend to think China has a not so great human rights record internally. But on the other hand, you don't see them killing many foreigners around the world. Whereas the U.S., for example, tends to be viewed as having a good human rights record as far as treating its own people. But then it might be a different story when it comes to people outside the borders. So I guess I'm just wondering how you think about that.
Mm-hmm. I think that is a bit of a quandary for human rights professional, because the human rights norms, all the treaty bodies, in the end, what they basically says is that the government undertakes to ensure the enjoyment of these rights for the people under its jurisdiction. And that's its citizens, but also non-citizens under its jurisdiction. But then we know that human rights violations happen by, not just by governments, but non-state actors across borders. So there is a consensus. There are still a few countries who will resent that. Those countries who stick to this notion of sovereignty. You know, anything inside that happens in my country is nobody else's business, including how we treat our citizens. That is the minority view. There is now consensus at the UN that human rights violations is an international issue. So that the UN is concerned about human rights violations anywhere, whether it's by the own government, whether it's by other governments having an effect. So, for example, the issue of drones, the issue of how the U.S. forces have treated its prisons in Abu Ghraib, how the inmates are being treated in Guantanamo. These are all human rights issues that the various UN human rights mechanisms are working on. Now, do you get the kind of response from the governments? You know, I think the special rapporteur on torture has not gotten a response from the government of the USA, for example, to visit Guantanamo. Huh? So the government response is the next step, but the idea that human rights is a global concern beyond boundaries is very much accepted, and certainly that's by the Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights that I worked for 6 years. That's the line we take.
Any other questions? Please feel free to go up to the mic.
Hi, my name is Hyun, and I'm a young professional in New York, and I'd like to ask a personal question, if you don't mind. Mm-hmm. Since I graduated from college, I have been a little overwhelmed by the number of choices that I have to make, especially career-wise, but sometimes non-career. And I'm sure you have made a lot of choices in your life, and maybe some good ones. So I would like to know, what are some of the things that you consider when you make important life choices?
Lucky to have so many choices. What are my... I think I always go for the new experience. I think, you know, when I was joining the Human Rights Office, a lot of my colleagues in the foreign ministries said, that's bold. You know, if I had stayed in the foreign ministry, I would have a rather safe career. I would get promoted and I would become ambassador somewhere. But to just jump ship and go on a completely different track was a risk. But I didn't feel it as a risk. I felt here's an opportunity to experience something entirely new. And I think whether that turned out to be success or failure, just the fact of having that experience was what led me to take up that job. And I think I would have done that, you know, if I had to think again, I would still have done it. And it turned out to be a wonderful experience. So the newness of the challenge is something that is I think what motivates me, and I've never thought of it, but now you make me think about it. But I think that's what's driven me. Of course, I make sure that my family is on board, and in the end, on a daily basis, I think what makes a day happy or not is to see, are your kids happy in the morning? If you leave a home with grumpy faces, you don't feel good the rest of the day. That was how things were when my kids were still young and teenagers. I remember those days very vividly. But that's the daily challenge. But that's a daily challenge, and you have to deal with it.
Hi, my name is Bora Lee. I work in public relations, and I actually read Lean In recently, and it stressed me out somewhat. So thanks for your perspective. It's comforting to know there are other paths. Regarding your work, there's been some crises, for example, the one in Rwanda that ultimately was resolved, but it took a long time to get there, and there was a lot of devastation leading up to it. And I was wondering, in your organization, how you define success. I mean, I think success is a hard word, but how do you measure progress when you're looking at these types of humanitarian issues? Mm.
Good question. And a difficult one, because the expectations on the UN is endless and keeps growing. As I said, as people's rights consciousness is heightened, there's the expectation then that those rights have to be protected and promoted. And if governments aren't able to do that, then the UN has to come in and do that. So the expectations are constantly rising, and you may be able to deliver on 99 things, but if you don't on one, then that's a failure. So I think, you know, the idea of managing those expectations and spelling out what the UN can and can't do is a daily challenge. For example, in South Sudan, one village I went to said, you know, when we were fighting, when they were, you know, still part of Sudan, and it was civil war, and there were they were fighting the Khartoum government as rebel forces. The UN came in and helped us and you know, gave us all kinds of things. But now we're an independent country, and the UN is not delivering as it used to. Because we can't, now we have a sovereign government that we need to support and work through. So we try to explain that, but of course from those in dire need, it's an esoteric argument. Success. You know, I always, you know, my answer to a reporter, what is success to you? And I thought about that. Individually, a success is, you know, leaving behind a good name, you know, a name that your children are proud of, a name that's, you know, is appreciated. Doesn't mean that there isn't failure along the way. And I take that from my father, who I think left me a wonderful name. And really, you know, I'm a very proud daughter of my father. Doesn't mean that he didn't have failures and heartaches and disappointments in his life, but overall, the name was an honorable name for his daughter to have. So for me, that individually, that's what I consider to be a success. But as an organization, I think something like that would also apply, but maybe not to such a simple, clear way. For the UN to have a good name vis-a-vis the people that we are trying to help. And yes, behind these failure stories that makes the headline, there are lots of success stories. There are, you know, areas of the world where the UN is hugely appreciated. So, you know, on balance, we would have to take a global stock of the value of the UN name. And then it makes it difficult, the added complexity is that UN is so many things. The UN sometimes is the member states, you know, the Security Council is the highest decision-making body. That is the only organization in the whole UN setup to be able to make binding decisions. You know, when the Security Council adopts a resolution under Chapter 7 on peace and security, the decisions are binding. Every member state has to abide by that decision. Other than that, there are recommendations. There's no binding force to that. You have laws, you have treaties that are negotiated, and once you signed on to that, then it becomes binding. But the resolutions, the daily decisions that the GA makes, these are all recommendations. So sometimes the UN is the Security Council. Sometimes the UN is the General Assembly. Sometimes the UN is the Secretary General. Sometimes the UN is individual departments or agencies, you know, like OCHA, like WFP, like WHO. But the media likes to just say sweepingly the UN without deep, you know, delving into to which part of the UN are we talking about. So it's in that context, it's very difficult to keep up that good name. But I think globally, overall, if we heard all, not just the failure stories, but the success stories, I think UN on balance is a very appreciated entity.
Hi, my name is Sang Wan Yoon. I'm a UN correspondent for Bloomberg News. I had a question about the lack of political will, perhaps, in granting access, humanitarian access. How do you deal with the frustrations in that warring parties or governments when they're unwilling to provide access and you are leading an organization that operates on a need basis? You see the suffering. Mm-hmm. And just now you also mentioned the Security Council, and that is the only UN organ that is able to generate binding resolutions. Mm-hmm. But laws are as effective as they are when their enforcement is ensured. Mm-hmm. Without an international body that ensures that, you know, enforcement is guaranteed, mm-hmm. you see that happening with various other resolutions. And for right now, I guess the namely Syria is the main issue when it comes to humanitarian access. Mm-hmm. So what new ways can OCHA find a way to sort of make it easier to deliver assistance, humanitarian mm-hmm. assistance. And yeah, that's my question.
That's the constant struggle on a daily basis. In the end, we have to get the agreement. And getting that agreement requires a lot of discussion, a lot of negotiations. And sometimes it happens, sometimes it doesn't. We've been trying, not just Syria, but we've been trying to have access to an area in Sudan that is controlled by rebel forces aligned to the SPLMN, which used to be aligned to the South Sudanese government. South Kordofan and Blue Nile, no access for humanitarian for a very, very long time. There's news coming out of that region that people basically are living in caves because all of their farmlands have been bombed. Polio vaccination is, I think, one of the first things to go in when crises happen, especially when there was no access, because without medical care, without monitoring, it's so easy to lose track of this fundamental, very basic immunization needs of the population. We try very hard. In fact, the Security Council had pronounced itself that all actors must try to give humanitarian access into these areas. When was it? Still nothing's happening. So it's hugely frustrating. Even when you do get that political will from the Security Council, at the end, if the political actors on the ground don't want to give us access, we don't. We don't, but the work must continue.
Hi. My name is James Park, architect, project architect, kind of career coach. My question is concerning all the humanitarian or Koreans, and the one sector it's worse needs really humanitarian is North Koreans. North Korean in North Korea, North Korean refugees, Korean refugees in South Korea, and North Korean refugees in the United States and rest of the world. And kind of surprised that that topic hasn't come up until my question. And you're from UN and had a diplomatic position in South Korea. And just want to hear your aspect. And from UN, I know there's some discussion in UN and some North Koreans spoke at the UN and speaking about it. And can you tell me about how is, from yourself as a Korean, to help North Koreans, and from the UN point of view, how is UN will be helping North Koreans and down the road, about unification. I mean, Korean society is part of that. So where is your feeling on that? Mm. Thank you.
Well, first of all, as you say, absolutely, DPRK is an international concern on the human rights front as well as the humanitarian front. But the North Koreans have rejected that human rights concern. It does not recognize the annual resolutions passed by the Human Rights Council and the General Assembly on the situation of human rights in North Korea. And we very much kept on abreast of this resolution working in the Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights. There's a lot of NGO activity, but in the end, the North Korean government has refused to cooperate on any aspect of the human rights challenges. On the humanitarian side also, it's a chronic situation, and the needs are huge. But because it has been so prolonged, there's the donor interest is very, very low. I think of all the countries that we make appeals for, this probably is the lowest funded. So we have an emergency pocket of money called SERF, the Central Emergency Revolving Fund, with which we were able to fund some UN entity activities in North Korea. For example, the WFP, we funded WFP to the tune of 6 million, 7 million, 8 million per year to be able to keep up their food distribution in North Korea. There was recent welcome news of the South Korean government giving $6 million to UNICEF and $6 million to the WHO. So there are some funds, but certainly not enough, not enough. You know, I would love to be able to see and go and see the country. Wearing my previous hat, probably that was a nil possibility. Wearing my current hat as the ASG of OCHA, I think the possibilities are higher now. But it is a huge concern on both fronts. But in the end, we need the cooperation of the government to make any headway in either of these fronts. Now, the fundamental question of the political issues, the nuclear issues, the missile issues, these require a political decision that resolves the situation. And that I very much hope that, you know, this, my father's family comes from the north. He's one of these countless separated families. So I very much hope that future is on the horizon.
I was just trying to get it down. I'm Rhonda Haubin, and I'm a resident correspondent at the UN. I cover for originally for Omi News International, but when they ended the English edition, then I now write for a blog at Die Tage Zeitung, the TAZ website, and it's called Netizen Blog, and it's essentially looking at netizens and the impact of netizen journalism. But my question to you is I think related to what was just presented, is that the Universal Periodic Review, I saw that your former office was supposed to deal with that, and I thought a piece of what North Korea says is that what's being done to them is essentially political and not objective in terms of the Human Rights Council activities. I thought the whole point of the Universal Periodic Review was to end the human or to have an alternative to the Human Rights Council being able to target particular countries mm-hmm. in a way that they would feel was political and wouldn't be accessible to. So I'm wondering if you can speak to whether the work you did on the Universal Periodic Review seems to be helping that obligation, you know, that effort, or if it doesn't seem to be, you know, to be achieving very much.
The UPR is a very important new tool for the UN's human rights work. It's part of the Human Rights Council's work. And I was, you know, very much part of the OCHA office that created the support structure for this. Yes, it's an intergovernmental discussion, but all the documents that go in, the proceedings, what comes out of it, this was all OHCHR work. And I'm very proud of the way that OHCHR colleagues have you know, lived up to that challenge and made this mechanism, I think by all accounts, a success, that it's been in the first round, and now it's gone into the second round. It is absolutely universal in the sense that all member countries come to the council to have a discussion with the council about its human rights record. All countries have done it for the first cycle. Now they're going into the second cycle, and this includes DPRK. Now, what the DPRK government comes to this and says in its response to the questions raised is probably what you're hearing. But by all measures, the UPR has been universal. I mean, all member states have been treated very equally. And some governments have taken the recommendations that come out of it to heart and have created national action plans to implement those recommendations. Other governments have said, you know, we accept this recommendation, but we can't accept these recommendations because we disagree or we're not prepared to do that at this point. So accepted, not accepted, pending. That's the usual outcome. North Korea has not accepted any of those recommendations, right? So it's a very exceptional case. But the process itself has been very non-selective and universal.
process going on that does target them. And so I'm wondering if that interferes with the
Yes, there is. I think you're talking about the country-specific resolutions. So this UPR is for all member states, and everybody comes to the council in accordance with prearranged schedules to discuss their human rights record. But then there are country-specific situations that is an ongoing concern of the Human Rights Council. And there are country-specific resolutions, such as on the DPRK, Syria, Myanmar. I think that, you know, there are a few country situations where the Human Rights Council has judged the situation to be so grave that it deserves the ongoing engagement of the Human Rights Council, and DPRK is one of them.
Okay, ladies, thank you so much for such an informative and truly inspirational conversation. We wanted to close today's program with the UN's World Humanitarian Day campaign's new video called hashtag the world needs more blank, which are the signs right here. And Dr. Kang, if you would like to give a little intro about the video.
Yeah, this is our campaign. This is an ongoing campaign. And David Guetta has very kindly composed a new song as part of this campaign, and we're very, very grateful for that. I've heard that song once, but I hear it's wonderful. We had another launch of this song with the SGN Valerie Amos not too long ago at UN headquarters, but we're hoping that this his name and this song will carry the campaign forward. What happens when somebody puts in a word here, then we have corporate sponsors who will match that with money committed previously. No, that's not as big as I had hoped it to be, but there are corporate sponsors. But beyond the corporate sponsor that this triggers, please join us in this campaign. And David, is the song is very much part of that. You will see some of these words in this video that he's produced.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Kang.
Thank you, Vivian.